The same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh yes, I will get you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my day. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, can I choose to praise? Can I choose to praise? To glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Can I choose to praise? To glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Can I choose to praise? Come on, lift your voice. To glorify, glorify the name of all names. It's Jesus. Then nothing can stand against. Then I choose to praise. To glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will get you high in the lowest valley.
Celebrate Jesus tonight.
Oh, we love to sing your praise. Oh, you're welcome here tonight.
Come on, just in your own words, would you just welcome him tonight?
Oh, you're welcome here, Lord. Oh, you're so, so good. Oh, you're so good to me. You're so good to us.
Let every heart adore.
Let every heart adore. Let every soul await. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place.
So good. Thank you, Jesus. This thing you stood before.
You stood before creation. Eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion. My soul now to stand. You stood before my failure, carried the cross for my shame. Thank you, Lord. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand.
Come on, let's sing this to him. So I'll stand.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart up. Soul, Lord, to you surrendered all I am.
walk upon salvation.
So I'll walk this path of salvation. Your Spirit of life in me. My life to declare your promise. My soul now to stand.
Come on, let's shout it out tonight. So I'll stand.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am, is yours. Oh, we worship you, Lord.
So what can I say?
So what can I say? What can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
Come on, we do that tonight.
So what can I say?
I'll stand.
So I'll stand.
That's our prayer tonight, Jesus. We're here to give ourselves to you. Whatever that looks like for you, raising your hands, taking a knee, just being quiet and standing there, would you just do that? Giving yourself to Him.
We're in awe of you tonight. So in awe of you, Lord. There's no one else like you, Lord. There's no one else like you. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who soul, Lord, to you surrendered all.
presence, just to be here among just with each other, just worshiping. And this is so good. We love you, Lord. forsaken, never abandoned.
to glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
That we can speak your words. Give us your ears so we can hear the things of you and shut out the lies of the enemy. Help us to have a clear mind, God, a mind that only comes from you. We want more of your Holy Spirit, God. You are welcome here, God. Your Holy Spirit is welcome here among us. And in us, and work through us, God. Give us your hands so that we can reach the people that need to be reached. Give us your feet to go to the places that you have called us to go. Soften our hearts, God, so that we can understand the things of you, so we can see people's pain, so we can understand people's pain, and that we can deliver the glory of Christ to them. Help us deliver your great commission to this earth, God. That is all we ask from you. That is all our mission is. Help us to spread Jesus Christ to those around us. Bring us to places that allows us to spread Jesus Christ to those people. I know I pray this all the time, but God, I pray that people see you in us. God, I pray that people see Jesus Christ in us and through us. They see your light, they see your kindness, they see your love, they see your holiness, your righteousness, your glory. They can see it shining through us, not by us, but through us and by Jesus Christ. I pray that you forgive us of our sins, God. There's so many out there. We fail so many times. And we need your grace. We need your forgiveness so that we can be that righteousness to these people that need us, need you. love you, God. I pray for everybody here that they can feel you tonight. I pray that you give them your mind. I pray that you teach them, that the words that Austin and Nicole are teaching, that reaches their hearts, reaches their minds, and that they understand your word better and they understand your love better tonight. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Amen.
Well, junior high, we love you guys. You guys are dismissed. All junior high students, unless you've already spoken with me about a different agreement, you guys are going with Norm and Nicole tonight. Love you guys. All right, let's get a seat. That was awesome. Woo! Can I unplug? Okay. Audience can hear if you don't have a mic. Have you guys ever watched our online? How many of you like checked out the online YouTube page before? Isn't it funny sometimes when we like forget to put a mic up talking, and you're online and you like can't hear anything? It's kind of actually really frustrating. So that's why I always make sure to have a microphone for you guys. But cool, I just want to say I'm glad that every one of you are here. I see some new faces tonight, and I'm just thankful that you chose to come to this youth group, and I hope you feel welcome. And yeah, God is good. Amen. Amen. He's good. I'll say it. Amen. Cool. Well, I have a couple things on the agenda tonight. How many of you guys are signed up for Camp Harvest? Let's see. Raise. Yeah, it's going to be awesome. You guys need to start thinking about what you're going to be packing for Camp Harvest. And if you have any questions about that, check out our social media page on Instagram. Even if you don't have Instagram, you can type it in online. Pull up Instagram, City Youth Senior High. We have a packing list that we're going to be posting, but if you guys have any questions about what you need to pack for Camp Harvest, please ask. Like, I would hate for you to show up to camp and like forget something, and now your camp experience is like horrible. So let me know if you have any questions, and I'd love to see you guys there. Oh, and Pete, aren't you guys in junior high, or did you're in ninth grade? The eighth grade move up is, eighth to ninth is August 25. So I think Norm and Nicole might want you guys to go back there. See, what? Yeah, just trust me, they'll be happy to have you guys. We love you, I wish you could stay. But Norm and Nicole just want you guys, yeah. Let's give them a clap, we love them. We're not kicking them out. We love you guys. You'll be with us, hey, well, you'll be with us in August. I'm not trying to be mean. Yeah, what's up? Yeah. So for those of you who are watching online, if there are any, basically there's a mud obstacle course where you just get totally like, you get slammed with mud. So you're going to wreck your clothes unless you bring some extra that you can just get rid of, especially your shoes. So remember to bring shoes, okay? Don't come to me, closed toe shoes. Don't come to me and ask for my shoes. I told you, bring your own shoes. So hopefully you guys can remember that. I'm trying to think of what else. I don't think there's anything else really. We have some events coming up, but Camp Harvest is kind of taking up all of our time right now. So without further ado, where's Gabe at? Oh, there he is. I'm going to have Gabe come up, and he's going to share what God laid on his heart about tithe and offering. And then he's going to pray for it, and we're going to move on to the next part of our service. So you want to come up, Gabe? Awesome. Let's welcome Gabe up.
Good evening. So the Lord has put on my heart 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 8. And let me just read it here real quick. If I speak in the tongues of men or angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor, and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away without love. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And that's something that has kind of convicted me lately. And you may be wondering how I'm going to tie this into offering, but it's something where that's how Jesus is towards us. And if we really think about that, that's actually quite beautiful. I mean, he's patient with us. He's kind with us. He's not out to get us. And even in our personal lives, you know, with how we are, we can take example from that. And we can think about, like, am I being this? Am I being love? So, anyway, as Jesus was love for us, he gave his life. And it was an act of love. And really, we give our offering to show that we love him and that we trust him. I mean, to really put it simply, our offerings are just a sign of love. Anyway, Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight, and we thank you that you're just coming and moving in this place. Father God, thank you for the offering that's going to be given. Thank you, Jesus, that you're going to bless it, and that it will go where you want it to go, Lord. We thank you so much for this right now in the name of Jesus. Amen.
After service, when we break for small groups, you guys can come up. It's going to be right here. And that money that you're giving is going still to Duane and Liz, missionaries in Alaska. So they're receiving that money. Thanks, Ethan, for bringing that stuff up. So I'm not going to be preaching tonight. We have the honor of hearing from someone new. You guys have got to listen to me tonight. So I don't know. Someone's probably excited about that. But Cliff's like, yeah. I don't want to take much of his time. Who's speaking tonight? His name is Zach Banks. Some of you guys have seen him around church. He works with our media team. He's just an amazing guy. So many behind-the-scenes things that this guy does helps make our church run and function smoothly. So could we welcome up Zach right now? Thanks, Zach. Appreciate you, man.
Hi. How you guys doing? All right, so what I'm going to be talking about tonight kind of goes right along with a lot of what Austin's been talking about lately with some of the stuff about identity and kind of learning what our identity is in God and what exactly that means. So what I'm going to be talking about is one big, giant piece of our identity. And that's the fact that we are all, every single one of us, made in the image of God. How many of you guys have heard that phrase before? Like, that phrase, image of God, you've heard that before? So for those who may not have heard that before, that comes from right in the beginning of the Bible, from right in the creation story, first chapter of Genesis. So right there in Genesis 1, I'll go ahead and read that. It says, "Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. So it says it like a bunch of times in that passage that that Adam and Eve were made in the image of God. And of course, since we're all descended from Adam and Eve, we of course also have the image of God. Every single human being who's ever lived has the image of God in them. But what exactly does that mean to be made in the image of God? We'll jump into some of the specifics a little later. But first, in order to fully understand it, you have to think, you know, what were the people in the Old Testament, when that was written, what would they have thought of when they heard the phrase image of God? What would the people in that time frame, from all cultures, what would they have thought of when they heard the phrase image of God? You guys have any ideas? There's two things that ancient cultures would have thought of when they heard the phrase image of God. Are there any guesses? Yep, like two things in their culture, things in their culture that they would have thought of. Things that would have been called images of God in that culture. Any ideas? Yeah. Yeah, that's a good, yep. That's one of them. So like you said, the first one are idols. Like, you know, it kind of makes sense. Idols are literally an image of a god, like a little statue or a carving or a painting or something that they'd have in a temple or someone would keep in their house. That would be an image of God that they would kind of, so it would stand in for God, that would kind of represent that god. You know, they'd sacrifice to it, worship it, that kind of thing. So the idols were literally an image of God. The second one are kings. Kings a lot of times were called images of God. And that's because they were seen as like divinely appointed to their position. They were divinely appointed to be king. So they were seen as the representative of God. I'm here to, you know, tell you what God thinks on earth and to my kingdom. So let's think about those two things, those two objects that they would have thought of when they heard image of God. And let's think about what we can pull out of that and how we can apply that to what it means for us to be images of God. So the first one, let's start with kings. Like I said, kings were kind of the singular representative of a god in a kingdom. They thought they were that. But when the Bible says that we're all the images of God, it kind of pushes back against that, right? It kind of says, it's not just you, king, it's everybody. Everybody's the image of God. It kind of elevates everybody and brings everybody to an equal footing. It doesn't say the king can kind of just lord over everybody and kind of push his rule on everybody. It brings us all into equal footing. But it also gives us all the same responsibility, right? We have the same responsibility to represent God. That responsibility is not all heaped on one person to represent God in a kingdom. Now it's on everybody. Everybody has that same responsibility. We're all given the privileges and responsibilities that come along with that. So what about idols? Well, it may sound kind of weird, but if you look at the original language, when the Bible says that we're all images of God, the same word it's using there was also for the word idols. So it's basically saying that we are all idols of God. That sounds kind of weird, right? Sounds kind of weird just to say we're idols. But what is an idol if not just a representation of God, a representative of God on earth? All right, and there again, that phrase kind of comes up again. I've said that a few different times. That's kind of the core of being images of God, is being a representative of God, a representation of God on earth. So the reason idols, saying we're idols, kind of sounds weird is because we're kind of told idols are a bad thing, right? Comes from the Ten Commandments. In Exodus 20, right there in the Ten Commandments, it says, "You shall not make for yourself an image or idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, Yahweh, your God, am a jealous God." So there's two things in that commandments that are going on. First thing is Yahweh doesn't want us to make any images of him. Why? Because he doesn't want us to worship anything but him, right? Because he's the only thing worthy of worship. That part of it kind of makes sense. But the second part of it is he doesn't want us to make any images of God. Like, why would that be? Why is that such a big deal? The first thing is because he's so amazing and like beyond our comprehension and beyond the physical world that any image we make of him is just going to kind of not really do the job right? It's not really going to do God justice. He can't really be contained in this one singular image. So we can't just do God justice with any image that we make. And the second reason, and this is really important, it kind of blew my mind when I learned it, Yahweh doesn't want us to make any idols or any images of him because he's already made images of himself in every single one of us. Right? He's already made the images. He doesn't want us to do it. Because again, we're kind of not doing, now we wouldn't be doing ourselves justice by making those idols in the same way we wouldn't be doing God justice. So that's why he doesn't want us to make idols, because we are those images of him. And once again, going back to the representation thing, that's what we're to do. We're to represent Yahweh on earth. That's what we're to do with the image that's in us, is to be those representatives, to be that image and that idol, so to speak, of God. Now, of course, we're not supposed to be worshipped like people sometimes do with idols, right? That's not our place. But we're to see the image of God in every single person around us and kind of use that to point us towards God, towards Yahweh, the one who made us. So at this point, you may be wondering, okay, so like specifically, like what are we talking about? Like, what is it? What does specifically it mean to bear the image of God? What does that mean for us? Does God look like us literally? If it's not that, like, what other things are there? Well, first off, I can tell you it's not physical. That's not what we're talking about. God doesn't have a face and two arms and two legs and hair. Like, that's not how it works. Jesus, of course, gained a physical body when he came to earth, but God the Father and the Holy Spirit, they're just spiritual beings, so they don't have bodies. So we're not talking about physical resemblance. So before I answer the question of what are we talking about, I'm kind of curious to hear what you guys think. What are some things that come to your mind as potential things about us that would point toward us being made in the image of God? What comes to mind when you think about that? What are some things about us as people that would be us being made in the image of God? What are some guesses you guys have? Yeah. What's that? Love, okay. So no wrong answers here. What do you guys think? Yeah. Okay. What else? Call them out. What was that? Peace. Okay, I heard someone say forgiveness. Excuse my bad handwriting. Yeah. Patience, okay. What else? What do you guys think? What are some? You got another one? Kindness, okay. Justice, all right. What else? What do you got? These are all great thoughts. Got one in the back? Self-control. What else? What are some other qualities or things about people that come to mind? Say it again. Gentleness. Kind of put that up with kindness. Any other thoughts? What do you guys think? Joy, you heard that one? Joy, faithfulness. These are all great. Conscience, okay. Anything else? Long suffering. These bring back a lot of memories. A lot of these are names of cabins at the camp I work at. Any other thoughts? What do you guys think? Human qualities that... Say the last part again? Yeah, yeah. Promises? Selflessness? Yeah. These are all great thoughts. You guys got anything else? Okay, the Holy Spirit. Yeah.
How hardworking someone is.
Hardworking, okay. All right, so I think we got a good start there. So a lot of, as you would imagine, like a lot of things in theology, some very smart people have thought about this thing for hundreds of years, and they've kind of come up with some categories that seem to fit all the different things about humans that point toward us being made in the image of God. And with this list, I think you guys might be surprised about some of them, kind of some of the categories you maybe weren't expecting. So we'll kind of go through the different categories, and we'll kind of see how some of the things you guys said fit. Maybe some things you weren't thinking of. So the first category is relationships, right? We as human beings have a need for relationship, right? I think everybody recognizes that in the secular world and the Christian world. It's just this innate human need for a relationship. We all want to have, you know, family and friends and significant other and people that we can just be close with. We have that need for human relationship. And not only do we have a need for it, we also have an ability for it, right? You know, we're pretty good at having relationships. We can kind of empathize with other people, and we can, understand how people are thinking and where they're coming from, and we can kind of just dig in and learn more about people and get close to them. That's just an ability we have as people, right? And here's the thing. We get that need from God, from Yahweh, because Yahweh himself also has a need for relationship. But the thing about him is that need for relationship he has is perfectly fulfilled in the Trinity. So that Trinity relationship perfectly fulfills his need for relationship. So he's kind of self-sustaining in that way. Now, we, of course, aren't perfect and we aren't self-sustaining, but we also can find that perfectly fulfilled relationship in God, right? And eventually, once we're in the new earth, we'll have that need for relationship perfectly fulfilled in God, ultimately. So we get that need and ability for relationships from God. The second category is emotions, right? We're pretty emotional beings, right? We feel emotions all the time, all sorts of different emotions. And we get that that ability to feel emotions from Yahweh. In the Bible, all the different members of the Trinity are shown to feel all sorts of emotions, from happiness, sadness, anger, jealousy, regret, compassion, love, graciousness, grief, hate. All of those things are emotions that the different members of the Trinity are shown to feel throughout the Bible. Like, that's a pretty wide range of emotions. So we get that emotional ability from God. Now, of course, he's not a fickle God. He's not, like, swayed by his emotions, and he doesn't change his emotions quickly and let himself be swayed by his emotions like we can sometimes. But that doesn't mean he's not an emotional being. He definitely is, and we get that ability from him. So the next one is spirituality. What I mean by that is we are, at least in part, spiritual beings, right? Austin mentioned this one. We're spiritual beings. We have a spirit and a soul as well as a physical body. We have that kind of, you know, different parts to us. And we get that spirituality, that spirit part of us from God. Because Yahweh is, of course, a spiritual being, like I mentioned. He doesn't have a physical appearance like we do. And this is actually more, you know, and the spirit part of us is actually unique to us, right, as humans. Like, there aren't any animals that have a spirit or a soul, right? We're the only ones who have that. We're unique in that sense because we got that from Yahweh. And this one's actually more important than you might think, because the only reason that we can relate with God is because of the spirit part of us. If we didn't have that, we wouldn't have the ability to relate with God, right? We can't relate with a spirit being if we're not at least in part spirit, right? That's kind of how that works. So we get that spirit part of us from Yahweh. Next one, this is one I heard a few people bring up. Morals, right? We kind of have a conscience in us, a sense of right and wrong, some kind of innate sense of morality inside of us, right? You'll even hear, like, little kids. Like, if they sense something's unfair, they're going to let you know, right? They already have that innate sense in us because they have that sense of justice and morality and right and wrong just kind of built into them. And of course, who's the source of all morals? God, right? God's the source of all morals, so and he's kind of the ultimate source of justice, and so we get that sense of morality and justice from him. This next one's one of my favorites. That's creativity, right? We're pretty creative beings, right? We can come up with some really cool stuff. Like, we can make new stuff all the time. We build crazy stuff like skyscrapers and beautiful cathedrals. We can invent new things. We can make art like sculptures and paintings you may see in museums. We'll make all sorts of crazy crazy music that's, you know, is all over the spectrum from classical to rock and all these things, right? We're pretty creative. We can come up with some crazy things. And we get that creativity from the source of all creativity, God, Yahweh, right? He's pretty creative. Like, he had to create the entire universe, and it takes a lot of creativity to do that, right? Like, he had to come up with all of the stuff in creation, planets, stars, galaxies, animals, and plants, and all the biology that goes into making those things work, physics and gravity that holds the whole universe together. He had to come up with all that from whole cloth, right? It takes a lot of creativity to do that. And because he's put that creativity into us, we can also become creators. We can also create. Of course, we can't create, you know, something out of nothing like he can, but we can still make new things and come up with new ideas, and he's given us that ability. So going right along with creativity is intelligence. Right? We're pretty intelligent beings, you know, pretty unique in the animal kingdom in that sense. And right, we can think logically, we can solve problems, and we can do all the things that we need to do all the creativity stuff, like, right, like do all the engineering to be able to build all the buildings and bridges and stuff. We can do science like medicine and psychology, and so we can study nature around us and learn from the world around us. And all of that knowledge and ability to kind of work things out comes from Yahweh, the source of all knowledge. You know, he knows everything. He created the world that gives us all this knowledge. And so we get that ability to kind of work things out and to learn and gain knowledge from him. So this last one is a pretty important one, and that's free will, right? We have the ability to make choices, right? We can make some real small choices like, oh, what am I gonna have for breakfast today? Or what clothes am I gonna wear? We can make a little bigger decisions, you know, like, oh, how am I gonna treat my friends today? Am I gonna be nice to them? Am I gonna obey my parents when they tell me to do the dishes? To some decisions that are, you know, pretty big decisions, like how am I gonna live my life? Like, what, you know, what kind of person am I gonna be? What am I gonna, you know, pursue for a career? Like those really big life decisions. And we can also have the free will to make the most important decision we can make of all time, which is, are we gonna choose to follow or reject Yahweh and the grace that he extends to us through Jesus, right? That's the most important choice we can make, and we have the free will to be able to make that decision. And that's pretty important because he wants it to be a choice. Because if it wasn't a choice, then we would just be, you know, robots who just kind of did whatever he told us to do. But because it's a free choice, that opens up the ability for us to have deep relationship with him and not just be people who are following him. So that free will is really important, and it's something that he gives to us. So as you can see, there's a lot of different things, a lot of different ways that we can bear the image of God. There's a lot of things that fit into that category, any of those different categories. And because it's such a wide-ranging group of characteristics, you probably see something about yourself that is your passion, your gift, the thing you really love to do that fits somewhere in one of these categories, right? And that's pretty important because that means that you, by living out whatever your passion or your talent or your gift is, it means you're bearing the image of God by doing that. And not only you're bearing the image of God by doing that, but it means you have a place in the body of Christ by doing that thing because you're living out the image of God in you by doing it. And there's a lot of space for you to be able to live that out. So the key points here are, number one, everyone bears the image of God. Every single person, every human being, no matter how good or bad throughout all of human history, has borne the image of God. We just have it. And because we're individually made in the image of God, it's our responsibility, our individual responsibility, to represent God well. How do we do that? Well, what does Jesus say the greatest commandment is? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Right? And he says everything resides on those two things. So that we doing those two things, that's how we live out the image of God, is by doing those two things. And going right along with that second commandment, love your neighbor as yourself, we need to make sure that we're viewing the people around us as being image bearers of God, and therefore worthy of us caring for them, and us caring for them like we would care for Jesus. Because Jesus says in Matthew 25, he's talking about the end times, about Judgment Day, and he's saying this is what I'm going to say to my followers at the end times. He says, "For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me." But then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" And the king will reply, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine," meaning the people around us, "you did for me." So right there, that goes right back to the idea of being representatives of God. Not only are we representatives of God to the world, but everyone else is a representative of God to us. When we treat the other people, we need to treat the other people, everyone else around us, as if we were going to treat God, because they are representatives of God just like we are. So make sure that you see, all of you see yourself as bearing the image of God individually. You yourself have the image of God in you. And make sure you see that, what a privilege that is, you know, for yourself. And also make sure you see every single person around you as bearing the image of God. And make sure that we're living out the responsibility to treat them and treat yourself as God calls us to, because we're image bearers. That's what I got.
Perfect. That was great. Well, thank you, Zach, for doing this tonight. Did you guys enjoy that?
Yeah.
Okay, so